Dan, Kyle, Will and Woody of Bestel, welcome back to Belgium, guys.
Thanks for having us, man.
Yeah, glad to have you. How are you guys? How have you been doing? The last time we saw each other or spoke to each other was Puckle Pop last summer. But you guys aren't playing in Belgium, are you?
No, we're not.
Anytime soon?
No. We were told that we had to have a year off playing in Belgium because, I don't know.
We had too much fun last time.
I'm really sad. I'm really sad. You have like genuinely two of the best festivals that we get to play all summer. So it's really...
So some bands do say that, but genuinely, one of my favourite gig moments ever was at Werchter in 2014.
Was it raining?
It was.
And then it stopped. And then...
But the people went back so far that you could see the kind of delay in sound reaching them. So when they're jumping, it was like a sea of people, literally. It was just the weirdest thing I've ever seen, but the best.
It was like a physics lesson.
It was like physics.
And it's the only time... This is so cheesy, but I never, ever come off stage and feel like that. You know, people talk about like getting that buzz after a gig. That's the only time in my life I've ever... Felt like a little bit.
The only time ever.
is that awful? Is that really bad? Not like I'm happy when you
know me.
Stage.
I'm the buzziest guy ever.
You are, Will.
You're always buzzed.
Practically jumping off the walls.
But that was proper like
rock and roll, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was nuts. Yeah. And then we had to leave straight away, so we didn't get to enjoy it. Way.
Yeah, but that's cool to hear. Now you're here with The Reason as well. Of course, there's a new single.
Yes.
Good Grief. It's called. What sparked Good Grief, this song? Was it a riff? Was it a piece of a lyric? Some groove? I don't know.
It's a good question. I think, like with our songs, often because I sort of they start life on my laptop before we start working on them. So I think it was the lyric and also the bass line. But at the time, it was on like a really bad keyboard sound until Will came along and injected some life into it.
Oh yeah, that's what I do. Give me the life injector.
The buzzing life injector.
Wow.
But listening to the song, I think it's really funky. It's you can surely dance to it. It's feel good. Any adjectives that I'm forgetting
very,
to add?
It's very Kelly LeBrock, I feel.
Yeah. With the quote in the
I think on the album it's definitely the happiest moment on the album, but it's still lyrically incredibly depressing, just like everything that we do. But I think without it the album might be quite bleak or not. Am I underselling it?
No, I just let everyone else decide when they hear it eventually
that
soon when it comes out.
Yeah.
When is a new album coming out?
That'll be telling
sometime in the next 45 years.
Okay, that's good.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
At least we got a title.
We've nailed it down to this century. So
before album 3.
Yeah, after album 1 before album 3.
Okay, I was just wondering about that.
Yeah. No, it's on its way soon.
If we say soon anymore, we're literally going to get lynched by a section of our fan base because they're getting a bit sick of hearing the word soon.
Yeah.
Imminently.
Like imminently. After the single, we'll get the single out of our system and then we'll put the album out, right?
Just like that.
That's
in the
we
single
are so good at promoting ourselves.
Yeah. In the single, one of the catchphrases is... watching through my fingers.
Mm-hmm.
Like most of the time when you're watching something through your fingers, you don't want to see it. You're scared of it. What's up with this?
Well, the song, like, I need to try and find a way of talking about it that isn't super depressing, but it's sort of about, I guess it's kind of about the process of loss and grief and then like euphoria that can come after, you know, and of ways of getting over stuff and coping with it. And I think the idea of watching through your fingers, it kind of extends, the whole album looks at kind of, like the world and how it's presented to us and how just a lot of fucked up things seem to be happening at the moment, but people are awesome, and sometimes you're sort of like watching these world events or whatever and you can't look away, but you know you almost just can't bring yourself to look properly. So I don't know, it's sort of about that, but I don't know, it's trying to find like good stuff in bad situations. Is I'm still talking, I should stop talking now.
I mean, you've answered the question.
Did I answer
it? Feel quite thoroughly.
So now I can put a full stop and
yes, so you stop talking.
All right,
next question
Woody.
Comes and then we go.
That's why you're the singer, man.
Because I won't shut up.
Yeah. you were just talking about the quote that was used in the beginning of the single and in the middle part as well.
Mm-hmm.
It's from Weird Science.
Yeah.
80s movie. It's a great movie. I totally forgot about it. But then just hearing the song and looking it up again, I'm like, oh, yeah, this one. Why did you decide to use the quote for this song? Why didn't it fit this track? Or did you just want to use it anywhere on the album?
Well, I thought like it kind of evokes a sense of nostalgia, and I think we've used quite a lot of quotes throughout mm-hmm. the album from documentaries and films and things, and it's almost, I think that the fun thing about using quotes in music is it is important where it's from, but it's also you can make something completely new. So the opening quote is kind of a bit of a joke towards like our fans and people who might have been waiting for the album for a while, but yeah, I think it kind of it's nice to put another voice in there, and it helps like in the record, it helps with the kind of, it's a bit like a mixtape, the album, and it kind of flows and there's lots of different like quotes and voices that come in and out, and I think it just helps break up my annoying singing voice for like little periods of time.
Thank God.
I know, exactly.
A little respite.
Yeah.
That's all you need.
Will he shut up? Was that the concept from the beginning, making it some kind of mixtape, making it all like flow into each other, or did you do that afterwards, after you had all the songs and then compiled?
No, it was kind of always the point, because we did these mixtapes before our first album, and because it was, they were covers and stuff, so we had this freedom of weaving in and out of different sort of songs and atmospheres and stuff. And I think we felt like maybe our first album was probably a slightly more straight down the line, like conventional record, and we wanted to mix it up a bit. Also, that we just touch on a lot of different sounds on this album, so there's kind of like heavier rock, and then there's like, you know, horns and almost like hip-hop production through to kind of this pop tune, and like I think doing that sort of weaving mixtape thing just allows you to, you know, to kind of, I don't know, sail between these different sounds a little bit more. I mean, maybe it's fucking awful, maybe it doesn't work at all, I don't know.
I mean, I didn't want to say anything, but yeah.
Sorry, buddy, I let you down, man.
Again,
any things you guys tried that you went overboard with and you didn't use on the record, you know, because you tried out these different genres, different ways of arranging songs?
We tried some instrumental tracks with Will just doing 4.5 minute bass solos, and that just didn't really fly.
We didn't do that. That's a joke. But we did do a guitar solo, which is the first time I've ever had a guitar solo in my life.
Yeah.
And then that became a joke because it gets like, it's made into a more comical element of a song than I wanted it to be. I wanted it to be like 8 minutes long. And I was going to grow my hair back and have a
We were going to get him a fan, just to have like a big fan to blow his hair.
And then they're like
the Steel Panther guys.
If you're having,
exactly.
If you're having a solo, it must be for the purposes of ridicule.
Oh. But I mean, so it's in there. But,
it's still there, but
someone turns it off after 5 seconds.
I wasn't going to give it away.
Oh, sorry.
I was being really cleverly circumlocution there.
What?
That was a clever circumlocution.
He's just breaking to Dutch, sorry.
He's making that word again. At least say it right.
I've been up for a while, guys.
Yeah, seems like it. Have you been having like heavy days doing promo?
This is the beginning of it, man.
This is just the beginning.
What? Yeah, it's just the
this
beginning.
Is a worrying sign. We've lost
which is why we're so fucking bad at talking, because we're well out of practice. So sorry.
We'll get it back. Don't worry.
Well, you had a good talk in DIY magazine. I saw you were on the cover of this month's edition, saying "fuck you, we're going to do what we want to do." That was the thing they got out of the interview.
Yeah, that one's got a potty mouth.
No, but as in, so by itself, with no context, it's like we're coming out balls out. Oh, we do whatever we want. But it was structured within a sentence.
Yeah.
That was really negative about ourselves, obviously.
Uh-huh.
And you know, they just decided to take it out and plonk it on the front, which makes us look like some people that we're not.
Well, like our friends and family and stuff were like, you said that. They're like, that's pretty out of character for you guys. But it was literally, we were talking about the question people keep asking us is like, you know, your first album did quite well. Like, why didn't you go and work with a really famous big producer? And we were just like, well, we work with our friend Mark. Mm-hmm. That's a massive part of the band, and yeah, it's a big part of Bastille. So I was like, well, fuck you. We want to do what we want to do. If we're going to develop and grow, we want to do it ourselves and not rely on like some old dude who's made loads of money and mm-hmm. doesn't really care. So like that was the point. And then the next thing we know, we look like these like little brats on the front of this magazine. Fuck you guys. Which was never the point. But you know, one person said, oh, it made you sound quite like Bad Boy. So I was like, all right, take that.
Dan's a bad man.
Nice as well. You were talking about Mark. It's Mark Crew.
Yes.
He's a guy who worked with a lot of fresh sounding bands like Coasts, Wombats. In what way is he the perfect fifth member for this record?
I think he's quite a good like quality barometer, and he also like a bit like us. He kind of just wants to experiment and try different things. I think the thing that I really enjoy about the work that we do is that there we don't really care about like genre or trying to be one thing or another thing. So, you know, like I think the album is a testament to that. Like there's some super depressing, dark electronic stuff, and there's like big over the top like guitar riffs and, you know, everything in between. And he's as up for experimenting as we are. So that's, and he's a nice guy, and he relentlessly takes the piss.
He's merciless.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So if you ever like, he would never, you could have just like done a vocal take and like poured your heart out, and he'll like pick a word in it that sounded stupid and just, I'm making him sound like an arsehole, aren't I?
He also once ate 3 kebabs in one day. I was there, I saw it. It was just needless.
That's not as impressive as you implied. I mean, I'm not recommending doing it.
Most people eat 3 meals in a day, right?
I'm sure I've had 3 kebabs.
Three kebabs.
You ate 4 haggis on your own once.
I did.
It's insane. I was there. I thought you were going to die.
I was hungry. I'm here.
You made it through.
I'm not going to get in between that. Yeah, you guys just eat what you want to eat. And
Glasgow does funny things to you.
There's 2 fan thingies that I wanted to run by you. First, there's a Wild World Communications, a brand new Bessel company that you've set up or like a way to sell the new album. What's that all about? Because you have to log into Facebook, send you guys a message. And
Fax
then
is coming back in a big way this year. So yeah, we're going to spearhead that technology.
The album via fax.
On sheet music by fax.
Oh, that's amazing.
You can do that. Yeah. It's still time. We can do it.
That's true. Time.
I guess we wanted to, it's this kind of like, within the world that we sort of like want to create with the music videos and the artwork and stuff, it's this kind of, a lot of the albums also kind of about like our relationship with cities and technology and stuff. So it's this kind of, it's this dystopian evil communications company that exists and does a bit of speaking on our behalf. Okay. Just because I don't know, I think we obviously love making music and we have this opportunity to release it and do something fun with it. So, you know, if it's the videos or the artwork or, you know, things like this, it's kind of a nice opportunity just to sort of to try out new things and have fun with it.
Okay, well, just say, I guess, say to the fans, go and check it out.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You have you like talk to it. It's artificial intelligence, people.
It's lonely. It wants to make friends.
It is, yeah.
And get a fax machine.
Yeah, it's crucial.
Okay, thank you so much, guys.
Thanks for having us.
For having me.